Hello, everyone, and welcome to Written for Life, a podcast to help you learn how to study your Bible. I'm your host, Chris Page, and thanks for joining us today. Today, we're going to talk about Bible translations. Bible translation and the history of how we got the Bible is a fascinating topic that we're not going to fully dive into today. There's some incredible resources out there. This is something I got to study specifically in seminary and loved this topic. And so I would love your questions to dive deeper on this. But today what we're really going to talk about is your modern English translations of the Bible and what the difference is between some of the different ones and why that's important when it comes to interpreting the Bible. All right, so let's dive in. First of all, it's important to remember that as we've already talked about, the Bible was originally written in different languages than English. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew and some in Aramaic, and then the New Testament was written in Greek. And throughout the years, those were translated from those languages into other languages like Latin, German, things like that, before they reached English. And then in recent decades, as we found more ancient copies of the Bible and of the original, you know, as close as we can get to the original texts, we've been able to go back and do better translating into English as we go from the original Greek and Hebrew words. And so we've ended up with all these English translations. Of course, the most famous English translation is the King James Version, written in the 1600s, authorized by King James of England. This is probably the most influential English version of the Bible, as they painstakingly went through and attempted to interpret, or not interpret, to translate the whole Bible into English. And a lot of your Bible study resources, like concordances that study a lot of the original Greek and Hebrew, are based on the King James Version. And so even though it can be more difficult to understand, as far as sometimes because it has an older sounding English style, kind of like Shakespeare a little bit, but it also is really valuable when it comes to studying the Bible and knowing what that translation is and how to use it. But there's other great translations as well. My favorite is the English Standard Version. There's other versions that are very similar. New American Standard, New King James Version, Christian Standard Bible, Holman Christian Standard Bible. New International Version is probably the most famous other translation, I would think, than the King James Version. As well as versions like the New Living Translation, the Living Bible, and the Message. And why I bring all these up is because we're going to talk about kind of what the difference is between some of them and how that plays into how you read them and understand the Bible. Because we've talked about that when God spoke to us through His Word, the Holy Spirit wrote this book through human authors so that we could understand who He is and how He wants us to respond to who He is. And so it's really important that we understand the Bible, and if we're going to get things out of it, then we need to know how to interpret it. And a lot of times that interpretation, of course, is based on words. And what sets all these English translations apart from each other is their choice of words. Now, there's two primary categories of Bible translations. There is word by word, and then there is thought for thought. Word for word and thought for thought. Now, what's important to recognize is there's no true word-for-word translation, because if we did it exactly word-for-word, there's a lot of times in those ancient languages like Hebrew or Greek that one English word doesn't equal one Hebrew word, or doesn't equal one Greek word. And sometimes meaning can be lost if it's not expounded upon when you're translating. Even talking about the word love, there's three different Greek words for love. And a lot of times in our English Bible, we just see love. But in Greek, it may be a different word in this passage from another. And so that's where that can come into play and why that's important. But word for word, attempts to try and interpret one word at a time and give us a phrase in English that the best represents each word in the original language. The Bible Project has a great article on this. It talks about if you tried to translate John 3:16 word to word into English, it would sound like this from Greek. For so loved God the world that His Son, the only begotten, He gave, that everyone who is believing on Him may not perish, but may live unto the age. And none of us have probably ever heard that verse said that way before. But that's how it would flow if we went directly from Greek to English without rearranging the words, without possibly choosing a word that communicates the same idea as the Greek word, but in English. And so, but word for word is the primary method of translations like King James Version, English Standard Version, Christian Standard Bible. I'm trying to think of a New King James, New American Standard. All of those translations like that aim for a more word-for-word interpretation. They're trying to take the original Greek and Hebrew words and put them into the closest representation in English that they can for exactly what that word, those words are. Now, thought-for-thought translations, the most famous one is the NIV, and then they're kind of on a spectrum. You know, I would say the NIV is the closest to word-for-word, but it is a thought-for-thought idea, right? And what thought-for-thought is they take the Greek, like we just read with that translation of John 3:16, and they try to figure out how can we say this in the most plain English way. And it may not be as focused on each word that we choose in English matching up to each word in Greek as much as is the words we're choosing in English matching up to what the verse is trying to communicate. So NIV is the most famous one of these, the New International Version. Other versions that are really popular are the Living Bible as well as the New Living Translation. Those two are two of the most famous. And then one that's farther down the spectrum where it's much more thought for thought is the Message Bible. Now we're going to read and give some examples of this so you can see the difference. All right. Again, I'm quoting a Bible Project article here, and it highlights several verses. We're going to look at one. Psalm 79:8. All right, I want you to listen closely to some of the different words that are chosen in this, and I'm going to read several different translations. I'll tell you which before I read it each time, and then we're going to talk about how that can make a difference in your interpretation and your application of that verse. All right, so here's the King James Version of Psalm 79:8. Oh, remember not against us former iniquities. Let thy tender mercies speedily prevent us, for we are brought very low. All right, it's not too bad. All right, I mean, that makes sense. It's a little fancy in its language, but I understand that. All right, New American Standard Bible. Do not hold us responsible for the guilty deeds of our forefathers. Let your compassion come quickly to meet us, for we have become very low. New International Version. Do not hold against us the sins of past generations. May your mercy come quickly to meet us, for we are in desperate need. The New Living Translation. Do not hold us guilty for the sins of our ancestors. Let your compassion quickly meet our needs, for we are on the brink of despair. The Message. Do not blame us for the sins of our parents. Hurry up and help us, for we are at the end of our rope. All right, so there's several different English translations of the same verse that was originally written in Hebrew, Psalm 79:8. So you probably noticed several things. First of all, it replaced this word mercies. King James says tender mercies. New American Standard says compassion. New International says mercy. New Living says compassion. The Message says help. And so all those words are interesting, and they're a different take on this original Hebrew word that is, I'm not sure exactly how to pronounce it, but rakum is the Greek word. I'm sorry, the Hebrew word. Rakum. And so all these different English translations have taken this word and given us an English word. Help, compassion, mercy, tender mercies. So which one is correct? And again, the translators are trying to give us an English word that best captures the Hebrew word so we can understand it. But you'll notice the word-for-word attempts, King James, New American Standard, say mercies and compassion. Now, Living Translation and New International also say mercy and compassion. But then the Message Version says help. Now, that doesn't mean that the word... I want to be careful because I don't want to be overly critical of any different English translation. But if you're reading the Bible to get the best understanding of what the original authors said and the depth of what they're trying to say, the word help is pretty bland. Because that's not close to what the other words are in some of these other translations. Mercies, compassion, that God is feeling something towards us, right? Even back to the King James Version, tender mercies, that he is these mercies that God cares about us in a tender way. And the word help just doesn't capture that, right? And so that's why that's important, why different translations can be so significant, especially when it comes to word-for-word or more summary-type thought-for-thought translations. Let's look at another part of that verse. The beginning, King James says, remember not against us former iniquities. The New American Standard says, don't hold us responsible for the guilty deeds of our forefathers. New International, don't hold against us the sins of past generations. New Living Translation, don't hold us guilty for the sins of our ancestors. The Message, don't blame us for the sins of our parents. Again, all of them say it in a very different way. The King James Version, former iniquities, that can be a little unclear. Former iniquities, whose former iniquities? Ours? Someone else's? But then some of these other word-for-words take it a step farther. Our forefathers, right, in New American Standard. New International, which is more thought-for-thought, says past generations. And so maybe these are capturing. New Living Translation says sins of our ancestors. So our ancestors, past generations, our forefathers, those are all circling around the same idea. And even the Message Version, sins of our parents, right, because our forefathers, our past generations, includes our parents. But again, once again, the word parents doesn't fully capture the meaning of the word, right? And so these are all English translations. They're all attempting to tell us what this verse says, but different translations are a little more close, or not even necessarily close to the original. What we're really trying to get at is they're best capturing what the verse was trying to say, right? And they give us the richness of the original words. And so there's more examples we could go through. This could be a really long episode of the podcast. But the important thing to recognize is, and I think the Bible Project gives a great summary here. When translations differ, we can wonder, did English culture change, or is something so fascinating and complex happening in the original languages that it can't be resolved with only one English word? It helps us to remember that our Bible is not an answer book or an instruction manual. It is a collection of sacred scriptures we are to meditate upon within community. A word in Hebrew, Greek, or Aramaic may not have an exact English word to match, and each language constructs sentence differently, which means a variety of words or reconstructed sentences will always be necessary. And a lot of times it can help to read a verse in different translations to give you a fuller meaning of, oh, that's that word or that phrase, and give you new insight into the depths of what it's trying to say. But when it comes to which translation should I read, all right, I've heard there's all kinds of opinions, and a lot of this is opinion. But again, remember, the goal is we want to correctly interpret what God said. And I believe that we do this best when we go as close to the original languages as we can get, to the words that God said to these people or that they wrote in. And so I think translations that aim for word by word are the best for Bible study, especially when you're going to start using other resources to study the words, because you'll say, oh, well, what's this word in Greek? What's this word in Hebrew? A lot of times the thought-for-thought translations, you're not going to find the English word in one of these resources that, those English translations chose, right? And so if you're really wanting to dig into Bible study, go with something like King James, New American Standard, English Standard Version. Those are great ones to go with for that. If you want somewhere more in the middle, something that's a little bit easier to read, but still, I feel like probably a great balance between word for word and thought for thought is the New International Version. It says it a little more plainly, but it typically doesn't venture far off from the words chosen for word by word type translations. Translations that make it even a little bit easier to understand, that maybe flow more naturally for the way we're used to hearing English, would be the New Living Translation or the Living Bible. But again, you want to be careful sometimes, because again, they're not wrong, but a lot of times their word choices, not in every verse, but in some verses, don't fully capture the original meaning of some of the words. The more you go thought for thought, because the way thought for thought is written is someone reads it in the original language, figures out what those words mean, and then says, well, what do I think that means in English? And that's the line is very blurred between translation giving us one language to another, and interpretation, this person deciding what they think that means and then telling us in English. And so again, I'm not against any of these translations over proponent of any of these translations. The point is, be discerning, dig into what you're reading. They're all attempting to tell us this is what God said, and reading different translations can help you in understanding the fullness of what the Bible says. But I hope this helps. If you have any further questions, feel free to comment on the podcast on YouTube or on Spotify. And thanks so much for listening. And we will see you next time on Written for Life.